If you are enrolled in this class and you are present on the call, will you please type your name in the chat so that I have a record of that? Again, if you're joining from the Monday class, not a necessary step today. And once we get attendance recorded, I'll start with just a little bit of housekeeping to just make sure that you are aware, kind of as the course is unfolding, reflection one should be in progress now. You're going to want to be at least thinking about that. It relates to the reading from chapter one. So this would be a good time to start on your first written reflection. I know some people have added the course late. So guidance for all of those is available either through a recorded session on the class page, or you've got some written information as well. Reach out to me if you have any questions. But reflection one is going to be in process now. And then for next time we meet on Tuesday next week, if you will just make sure that you come prepared, having read chapter three in the text, that's the chapter on gender and diversity. Just make sure that you're familiar enough with that content that you can sort of present the information back to the group. We're going to probably start out in a breakout session so that you guys can compose your thoughts, but it's going to be a flipped classroom model where you guys will be presenting that content more than me. So you got to come knowing what you're talking about for next week. The asynchronous content for Thursday is posted to the class page. I'm asking you to do a couple of online assignments and then some written and verbal reflection on those. And then one of the readings is just for talking points for our next class meeting. So make sure you access that and get it done by Thursday during our class time so that you get your attendance and participation for that. And with that, we're going to start our session today in small groups, and we're going to do a little bit of review and reflection on those theories, the theoretical models that we talked about last class. So I gave you about 9 different theoretical approaches to help understand relationships. And if you can, there's a handout on the class page under week 2 called the group grid. I didn't make it visible until now because I didn't want you to think you had something that you needed to do before we met. But if you're able to pull that up on your screen, it's just going to be kind of a matching activity where you work through moving these different scenarios that are listed at the bottom of the grid into their appropriate theoretical framework. And so I'm going to have you guys in breakout groups to have those conversations, and then we'll come back to the large group and talk about why you put things where you did. Any questions on what we're doing before we go to do it?
I just had a quick question about the reflection, just very quickly. Mm-hmm. Is that 1 to 2 pages over just chapter one or chapter one and chapter two?
So what you're going to do, if you look at the assignment handout, it's an excerpt from chapter one. It's on page 18 of the text. And in the hard copy book, I don't know if you can see what I'm holding up. I can't find myself.
Yeah, I can.
In the hard copy, it's this pop-out text called Couple Preparation and Relationship Education. So that's the actual reading that you're going to be summarizing. So the first step is to summarize. Then the second step is to make connections. And you might make connections to chapter one or chapter two. Really, that's up to you. And then the third piece is to do your own personal reflection or your own, you know, thought sharing process around that topic.
Okay, thank you so much. And that's using like everything we learned from like the presentation, like the different theories and stuff. Yep. To relate it back to that chapter.
Yep. As we move further along, you know, you might draw on something from early on in the semester when you're writing about one of these things that comes up later on. So you can really use any content that's presented in this course or in our text to relate in that second component of the written piece. Yeah.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Anything else before we go into breakout rooms? Okay, so make sure when you do this work together that you're able not just to tell me what scenario goes with what theory, but why. Help me to understand your rationale for why you put that there, okay? And you might need your text in order to do that. I'll hop around and check in with you in the breakout rooms as this is happening, and then we'll come back together in a few. All right, the rooms are open. All right, welcome back. As everybody's kind of leaving the breakout rooms and coming back together, I took a few minutes while you were in your rooms. I just wrote down the name of the first person as it was listed on my end as a representative from each group. So if I call on you, will you please talk me through what you put for, so I'm gonna start on the grid. On the far left, family life course development from group one, I have Aaron Simpson. Aaron, will you share with us what you guys decided to put there and why?
Yes. So for the first one, we said family systems. We basically explained it that the woman and her partner each have their own role. The woman is more of the caregiver and the man is the breadwinner.
Okay. So you put that in family systems, is that what you said?
Yes, the first one, yes.
Okay, so, okay. Sorry, I've moved them around on my end. So read me the scenario, if you will.
Okay, a woman appreciates that her partner's income allows them to live comfortably and that she can stay home with their children.
Okay. Does anyone have that in a different place?
I do.
Will you share what you put?
Sorry, my camera's not working, but I put down a social exchange because of the cost profit aspect. Me, Skyly, and Lauren totally did that. We understood the structure in terms of family system, but we thought that the cost profit applied better, especially at the mention of her partner's income.
Yes. Yes, so I would agree with you. And I 100% see how family systems thinking comes into play here. But I do think that there's, the most appropriate answer is that family, I'm sorry, that, this is a lot of back and forth, social exchange theory. When we think about a woman appreciates that her partner's income allows them to live comfortably and that she can stay home with their children. Because again, social exchange theory helps us understand relationships and marriages in particular in terms of cost and profit or risk versus reward. And so that idea of income and what it affords to the other partner, that does kind of speak to that component of the social exchange and that cost versus benefit. So yes, and there's one for the family systems that speaks a little bit more to those rules and roles that group one pointed out are, yes, a part of the family systems. So just for clarity's sake, for social exchange theory, the best answer is woman appreciates that her partner's income allows her to stay home with the children. Okay. Group two, I have Callie Matthews. Will you tell us? And so on my end, I've moved the scenarios around already. So I'm looking at the theory. So tell us what you have for family life course development. What scenario did you put there?
A child raised in a loving home with committed parents tends to have better social and academic outcomes.
Okay. Does anyone have anything different for family life course development? Is it Aria? Aria? I see you nodding your head.
Yeah, it's Aria.
Aria,
our group for family life course development, mm-hmm. We put a husband and wife to just decide to buy a new home with more space before their first baby arrives.
Okay, and tell me why you thought that.
We put that because it's emphasizing a transition throughout like their life because they're having a baby, and then that transition calls for a bigger home.
Yes. So the family life course development theory is looking sort of at these milestones in the development of the family. So newlyweds, parenting, retirement, all of those kind of pivotal moments that happen over the course of a life or a family's time together. That's what we're kind of focusing on in that family life course development theory. So yes, the purchase of a new home so that you have more space for a coming, you know, baby really speaks to life course development the most. Okay, group three, I have Jessica Todd, and the question now is about the human ecology theory.
Okay, for that one, we put a child raised in a loving home with committed parents tends to have better social and academic outcomes, because this was relating to like the, I think it was like the macro, micro, like how they interact with families. And so for the social and academic outcomes, that's why we put that there.
Okay. I can see that. And I think we could make the argument that, you know, I guess there's a lot of overlay in these. Does anyone see that there's a better fit for human ecology in thinking about the micro macro systems? Allie, you're south, you're shaking your head. What do you think?
Yes, my group said for the human ecology one, homeschool feels like the best choice for us now because of COVID. And we believe that that was the answer or went with that one because the family is the ecosystem and interacts with the environment. So they're interacting in their smaller environment for the sake of like their own well-being.
Yes, as it relates to that macro system, global pandemic environment. So things that are happening because of COVID in the world have impacted, you know, a parent's decision to take their child out of the public school system and keep them at home. That's an example of the human ecology model primarily. So yes, that is what I would say would be the best option there. Let's go this route. Who feels really confident about their answer for feminist theory and is willing to share? Catherine?
I put the gender pay gap is expressed in the coined phrase, the glass ceiling, because I just personally knew that the glass ceiling was like a phrase for the feminism. Mm-hmm. So that's how I connected the two.
Right. Well, and feminist theory is not just a theory that helps us understand oppression of women, but it also oppression of women in marriage and relationships, but it also helps us understand oppression of minority groups in different contexts, right? So women in the workplace can be understood through feminist theory as well. So yes, that's the answer on that one. What about conflict theory? Who thinks they know which scenario best exemplifies conflict theory?
Wouldn't that be the one where the partners agree to get married and then decide that they can't get married anymore? Married.
Partners agreed to be married after they've lived together for a year, and then the woman decides that she isn't ready to be married. The man feels hurt and deceived. Yeah, and that's because conflict theory gives us a framework for understanding conflict and, you know, these different sort of things that arise within relationships and that relationships, you know, conflict is a natural part of those. What about symbolic interaction? Someone think they have the answer for that? Alex?
Yeah, I think that the symbolic one was my partner always laughs at my jokes. I think I have a good sense of humor, just because when you think about it symbolically, like if it says mean to each other's behavior, if you like say a funny remark and your partner laughs at it, technically you're symbolizing the laughter as you being funny. And so that's why I assume that my partner always laughs at my jokes. I think I have a good sense of humor. The I have a good sense of humor part would be the assumption from the symbolic laugh, basically, yes. If that makes sense.
Yep. Yep. So the symbolic interaction theory gives us kind of a context for understanding ourselves through the lens of our partners in relationships. And so, as Alex just said, this assumption that I have a good sense of humor is coming from that feedback that a person is getting from their partner in the form of laughter at their jokes. It's directly related to the concept of the looking glass self, which is this idea that we understand ourselves through kind of the reflection that we see through other people. What about structure function framework? Did anyone feel confident in what they put, Madison? I'm sorry.
Is there more than one Madison?
I don't know. I saw your hand up, but I don't know. Someone else might have started to share.
Oh, well, if they did, that's okay, but I don't know. Should I?
Take it away.
Okay. You said structure function framework. Yes. A child raised in a loving home with committed parents tends to grow up to have better social and academic outcomes.
Yes. And why?
Because they're raising a child that will contribute to society, which fits the theory that I've lost now my place, but
that's the premise of the theory, right? Is that happy, stable relationships produce functioning members of society, and that's how we understand, relationships through the context of that structural function. Is that that's the function of the family, is to produce contributing members of society. And so, yes, a child raised in a loving home that tends to have better outcomes long term is an example of that theory in practice. Family systems, we've got two more. If you're willing to share on family systems, just unmute and.
Isn't that the?
Go ahead. Sorry.
You're fine. The family has a rule that they sit down for. I got that one and structured function framework mixed up, which makes sense because I was like the sitting down once a day to have a meal was like structure, okay. But it makes more sense for a family system now.
Yes. So family has a rule that everyone sits down at the table to eat dinner at the same time is an example of family systems, because family systems framework views each member of the family as part of a system and the family itself as a unit that develops norms of interaction. So the rules that the family comes up with, the roles of each family member within that family system, those are all related to this idea of the family systems framework. And then the final piece, couple and family technology framework. Through process of elimination, we can know that a couple deciding that they will give up social media for a month in an attempt to reconnect and spend more time together is an example of couple and family technology. And again, this is just how we understand how families relate to and operate with using technology in their relationships with one another. Okay. I will post the correct version of this document to our group page so that you can refer back to it. And I would encourage you, if this felt hard, I would encourage you to go back, reread how these theories the frameworks and how they help us understand relationships, and then do some more thinking about, adapting these frameworks out into real life scenarios. I think I said this to most everyone in the small groups, but your exam one will have a few questions like this where you read a scenario and then you select which theory it best fits with. So make sure if this is like what in the world are you talking about, that you touch base with me before we get to exam one, so that you will be successful. All right. I am going to open up. Today we're going to be talking about love and attachment. And so I will share my screen with you. And again, if you want to go in and take notes in the PowerPoint for your own benefit, I've left them mostly open-ended so that we can just have conversation, and then you can fill in as we go. All right, plans for today. In the rest of our time together, we're going to discuss the meaning of love. We're going to talk about some theories, again, that help us understand understand love, the process of love, different types of love, that type of thing. We'll talk about some contexts for social control of love, some conditions for love, and then some problematic pieces of love, including jealousy, and also going to talk just a minute about the concept of polyamory, which is love of more than one. So when we think about meanings of love, there are a few different sort of ways of thinking about love, and ways that love can present itself in a person's life. One of those being romantic love. So we think about romance as, you know, passion, intensity, kind of this state of intense longing. That's romantic love. Another type of love is realistic love, sometimes also called conjugal love. And this is more about companionship, calm, secure, comfortable love, if you will. Not to say that it can't have that romantic component, but it doesn't always necessarily. They're not mutually exclusive of one another, but they're not the same thing. You can have this type of realistic love with a partner that you might not have any romantic feelings towards, or with, you know, a child or some other person that you relate with. And then another kind of context for understanding love is lust or infatuation. This is different from romantic passion in that it's often not based on reason. This is like crazy love. infatuation, you know, and sometimes we see things like crimes of passion, you know, affairs, those type of things that are born out of this infatuation or lust for another person, when it doesn't necessarily make sense, you know, for what's like best in your life necessarily. So some different love styles. These are coming to you from a theorist named John Lee. He developed these love styles in the 70s and 80s. And this was one of the first kind of theories of love. So I'm going to ask this question, and we just did some work with theories for understanding relationships. Now we're talking about theories to help us understand love as a concept. What's the point of these theories? Why do we need these type of theories in the social sciences world? Who has an idea?
So you can understand like human behaviors?
Yeah. Yeah, they help us understand human behaviors as well as our own human experience with something. That is, love is pretty abstract, you know, relating to other people in a lot of ways can be a pretty abstract concept. And so people have carved a path, if you will. They've laid out these kind of paradigms for us to think about love in a certain way. And so these different love styles, they kind of speak to some of what I've already talked about in that, like Eros, for an example, that is romance, passion, desire. ludic love looks at love as a type of game that is not serious in any way. It's a, you know, I want to say player's going to play, but I'm not going to say it. but you know, it's just this, it's like a loose thing. It's not a serious idea in this ludic approach. Pragma. Pragma is kind of the complete opposite of that. It's a very logical, rational approach to love. It relates back to one of the theories that we just talked about, the social exchange theory, in that pragma is really focused on how does love benefit me and what's it going to cost me? It's a pragmatic approach to the idea of love. I already said Eros is a passion or a romantic love. Mania, that's what we talked about before in that infatuation type love, lust. It's a crazy love, must have the other person. And mania type of love can often lead to jealousy, possessiveness, and a dependent type of situation. Storge love, or compassionate love. This relates back to that second type of love that I mentioned on the first slide, and in that it's more of a companionate love. It doesn't have that intense passion, and it's more about respect, friendship, commitment. Those are some of the kind of key ideas when we think about storge love. And then agape, or compassionate love. This is a love that is focused on another person's well-being. This type of love is often associated with like a parent-child relationship. But there are, you know, partners who are in marriages in this type of compassionate, more companionate love, which would be a storge love. But, you know, again, these love styles can show up in various relationships that we have in our lives. And they all just sort of feel and are expressed a little bit differently.
I'm sorry, could you possibly say the third one more time, like what it means?
Eros?
Yes.
Yeah, it's romantic love, passionate, sometimes based just on sexual desire.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions about those different love styles?
I do have like one question in regards to the storge and the agape one.
Yes.
Did you classify both of those as compassionate loves?
So agape, the last one on the list, that is more compassionate. Storge love is more companionate. So I often think of storge as more just like friendship level love, if you will. Like I've decided to, you know, partner with someone, we have a life together, but we don't have that passion, romance, sexual stuff. We're just companions. That's storge love. Agape, compassionate love is really, you might think of it in more of like a caretaking role. And so an example of that might be as a couple gets older and one of them is less able to participate in the relationship in the same ways, the love just shifts then from more of an Eros or a storge love to that agape love, where I then become the caretaker for my partner as they're ailing, in later life or something along those lines. Does that help you understand it a little better?
Yes, very much so. Thank you.
You're welcome.
I have a question also real quick on the love styles.
Yep.
What is the difference between pragma and, how do you say that, Eros?
Yes. So pragma is pragmatic. And if you understand what that word means, it means that you've sort of thought through how this is going to be practical in my life. So, you know, from a really kind of functional standpoint, pragma love is I've decided that, you know, it's financially advantageous to have a partner who I'm building a life with so that we can have a dual income. We own a home together. We're raising children together. That's pragma love.
I think I meant mania.
Oh, okay. Sorry. Yep. So mania, eros is kind of that element of love that connects us to each other physically. It's like passionate desire. Mania is taking that to kind of a crazy level, if you will. And mania is, you know, it's kind of an unhealthy dynamic. It's this possessive, jealous, must have type of love. That's how I would distinguish those two.
Thank you.
I would say eros is, you know, a healthy part of a good relationship, and mania probably not so much.
So what do you do if like a relationship includes multiples of these? Because like you could argue that eros could turn to mania, or that eros could turn to pragmaticness depending upon time. So how do you like deal with that if you're trying to identify it?
Well, I think that, you know, that brings up the point that these are not mutually exclusive of one another. You can have, I mean, in my own relationships, I can see how some of these have shown up over time. And in the example I gave about, you know, the shift in life course development, your love is going to shift at some point to a different love style. Probably there might still be elements of that eros piece when you're, you know, 85, but probably not like it is in your 20s. That's just reality. And so, you know, that's a normal part of development and of human relationships. For the mania piece, I think it would just be important to see, you know, kind of see that as a red flag. And if we're going to talk more about abusive relationships and some ideas related to unhealthy patterns of relating to other people, and I would just say that, you know, that would be, if I were feeling those feelings myself, or if I was experiencing the impact of someone else seeming to feel those feelings, that would be a red flag for me that, you know, our relationship might need some outside support. Does that help answer your question?
Yeah, I just asked it. It might have been a dumb question, but I just want to
clarify. Oh, no, there are no dumb questions. I think you brought a great point to the table that, you know, these do kind of ebb and flow over the course of time, and they can change. And there are elements of multiple styles of love in most relationships. So another theory or way to understand love is Sternberg's triangular view of love. And basically what he's talking about these different concepts of non-love, liking, infatuation, romance. You can see this visual over here where he's got basically your spirit, which is related to your level of commitment, your spirit or your soul, your mind, which is related to your level of intimacy, and then your body, which relates to your level of passion. And then he has developed this model for kind of understanding through these three basic elements, your intimacy, your passion, and your commitment, different views of love. So that companionate love is a combination in his idea of non-committed or empty love and liking. And when you have non-committed liking partners, that might result in companionate love, where, you know, they're kind of embarking on this like friend journey together. So not necessarily committed in a romantic relationship, but they like one another. Infatuation related to lack of commitment can result in fatuous love, which is exactly what I just said, infatuation with a lack of commitment. If you have infatuation coupled with intimacy, you would have what we call romantic love. So you're infatuated with another person in that sort of physical, passionate way. You like them as a human. And so you have this romance happening. And then when those concepts, passion, intimacy, and commitment overlay, it results in consummate love. You can see how I'm talking through this Venn diagram related to his ideas. And I'm not going to spend much more time on this. There is a handout on the course page as an additional reading. And it has got this theory broken down in much more kind of readable terms for those of you who aren't visual. There's also another visual layout there that might be useful. So I would encourage you to take a look at that once we're off the call and just try to wrap your head around this triangular view of love. But the main thing that I want you to know is that it's different combinations of these three basic elements, intimacy, passion, and commitment, and then how they sort of show up. I'm not going to expect that you memorize what goes with what or anything like that. Languages of love. This has become, this is kind of the most modern sort of theoretical view on love or way to understand love. You might have been familiar with this. It is, you know, pretty commonplace now from 2010, Gary Chapman, but he developed these languages of love. And this shows up now like in your appreciation language in the workplace. They've kind of expanded this this idea out a little bit more. But basically the premise here is that we all identify with one of these as being our love language. It's either gifts, quality time with a partner, words of affirmation, acts of service from a partner, or physical touch. There's a quick link here from Gary Chapman that just gives you like maybe a 3-minute summary of his ideas on this. I would also encourage you to go back to that when you have some time. And then one of your reflection pieces for Thursday is related to this love language piece. So you'll get to explore what is your own love language and then kind of reflect on that just a little bit in a discussion forum. And then the idea of social control of love, this is just about how sometimes other players in the game become involved in the romantic or the love relationships between two partners. So one of the kind of obvious examples of that is in arranged marriages. And these are still fairly commonplace in about 40% of the world's population. Folks are still experiencing this idea of arranged marriage. We might also see social control of love show up when we see parents disapproving of their child's partner choices, perhaps because they're the same gender, same sex, same sex, interracial or cultural partners that are different for the family of origin or the family of orientation. And so if we see disapproval of that, that's an idea of social control of love. And then one of your little excerpt readings from chapter 2 is about office romance, workplace romance. And sometimes we see that these are frowned upon. And so there's some ideas related to that in terms of social control in the workplace and trying to prevent romantic relationships from happening. So we've talked about these different sort of views of love, ways to understand love. And then these are just some theories that help us kind of get at the why behind love. So like, what is the functionality of love in our lives? The first one is evolutionary theory. This is just the understanding that love serves an evolutionary purpose because it provides a bond between two adults who then become parents to offspring that are dependent upon them. It's a very basic, way of looking at love as it functions for our species. Learning theory. Learning theory is kind of related to that symbolic interaction. And so it's that love gives us, love is born out of our understanding of the behavior of others and how we respond to the behavior of each partner. So when we think about smiles, touch, gestures, those type of things, learning theory suggests that over time, love feelings develop as a result of those behaviors and our experiences with those behaviors. The sociological theory, basically just suggests that love is a means of sensual salvation in a world that is based on more informal social relationships. So this theory kind of views love as like a safe haven, a different type of relationship in a world that is based on social relationships. We have this one that stands out, and that's our love relationship. The one with our partner that stands out from all the other social relationships. Psychosexual theory, again, a really basic view of love, born out of the sexual repression of early 1900s society. This idea here is that love was a result of blocked biological sexual desires. So the idea is that, you know, partners developed these love feelings as they were waiting to engage in sexual acts with one another. Another theory, biochemical theory, basically says that love is a hormonal cocktail that happens in your brain. We do understand that love actions produce hormones like oxytocin and PEA. I'm not going to even try to butcher that word. Phenylethylamine. That these chemical reactions in the brain do happen as a result of physical interaction. And so basically the theory here is that you develop this love feeling based on those chemical processes and those hormones that are released in the brain. And then the last one is attachment theory. Attachment theory is sort of related to that evolutionary theory that the primary motivation in life is connection to others, and that spouses bond with one another and then they bond with their children as well. So attachment to primary people in our lives is a functionality of love. So now I'm going to kind of shift gears a little bit to thinking about how does love happen? What are the conditions required for love to occur? There are some social conditions. Those include cultural expectations, cultural norms. We're going to take a little bit of a deeper look in one of your readings for Thursday about like the media influence on our cultural perceptions of love. And so all of that kind of feeds into this conversation that we're having about what are the social conditions for love. There are also physical conditions for love. And some of these relate to cultural norms. So in our society, we have some cultural norms around appearance. And those relate to, you know, how attracted we are to another person. The text points out that BMI has a relationship to the probability of love relationships in a person's life. And it's related to lower quality relationships as well. Sorry, I was seeing something in the chat. And then in addition to social and physical conditions for love, we also have psychological conditions for love. Those include our perception of other people liking us, our own personality qualities, our self-esteem, and our ability to self-disclose. Self-disclosure is related to your level of openness and trust with another person. There are some specifics in the text on page 42 that you might refer to for a lengthier list. But some of the ideas around self-disclosure are like, how open and honest am I about my personal background, my financial state, my feelings? How able am I to discuss those? These are all psychological conditions that allow us to experience love either in a greater or a lesser way. And then, as I said, we're going to think for just a few minutes about love as a context for problems. So love does come with some issues. There are experiences like unrequited love, love that is one-sided and not returned. Sometimes love causes people to make risky choices. People engage in, you know, sometimes dangerous behaviors. The book gives an example of like non-smokers. A large percentage of non-smokers that fall in love with smokers become smokers. And that's kind of a poor life choice. Condom use is another one. Sometimes, you know, risky sexual behaviors are born out of love issues. There's a quote in the text from Plato. He says, love is a grave mental illness. And that kind of sums up this idea. Sometimes, as I talked about before, family of origin has issue with, you know, love relationships. And so sometimes embarking on a love relationship means breaking away from other relationships that you once held. There's also the issue of simultaneous loves. What do we do when we feel these feelings for more than one person at a time? Issues of abuse and stalking, which again, we'll talk much more about those type of things a little later on. Gaslighting and emotional manipulation, those can be really negative, you know, experiences that can come in the love relationship. Does everyone understand what I say when I say the term gaslighting? Could someone give us like a layman's definition of that or an example?
It's convincing someone that their feelings are invalid because you feel that they're invalid. A good example would be Mother Gothel with Tangled. Mm-hmm. She convinces Rapunzel essentially that she's stupid when Rapunzel is actually pretty smart considering she's been locked in a tower her entire life. When she, you know, she charted like literally all the stars and she's like, no, these are lantern, and like convinced her, actually, you're wrong, when in all reality, she was right because that's what Mother Gothel wanted her to believe.
Yes, I love that example. Makes me want to sing Mother Knows Best, but I will spare you. I will spare you that experience. But yes, it's basically the invalidation of someone else's feelings, of someone else's experience. Sometimes it's just such a simple thing as like, I didn't say that. You know, those type of interactions where you're minimizing the partner's experience with the reality that occurred. And that is a form of emotional manipulation. And then there's also this issue at the loss of love. There can often be, you know, this profound sadness, sense of loss, depression, that can be a very impactful experience in a person's life. And so that's another key issue to be aware of as it relates to love. A final key issue that warrants its own heading is this idea of jealousy, which is emotional reaction to either a perceived or a real threat to a valued relationship. So jealousy, you know, kind of a familiar-ish, I think, issue that shows up in love relationships at times. And there's different types of jealousies. There is reactive jealousy. This is a feeling of jealousy that is in reaction to something a partner is doing. So if I see you, if I see my husband, you know, texting a previous partner, that could create a reactive jealousy within me. There's also anxious jealousy, which is not necessarily reactive to anything. It's just based on these obsessive thoughts that my husband might cheat on me. And so I kind of create this jealousy in my own mind. And then possessive jealousy is where we see someone actually acting on these jealous feelings and, you know, doing something to either the partner or the alleged person that the partner is engaging with. And so this is related to those ideas of like crimes of passion and things like this, and relates back to that mania type of love that we described at the beginning of the call, possessive jealousy. Jealousy can be caused by external. As I said, if I observe my partner doing something that is, you know, cause for concern, I might feel a jealous reaction to that. But jealousy is oftentimes born out of more internal issues, such as my own mistrust, my own insecurity, my own low self-esteem, or sometimes lack of perceived alternatives. What's meant by that is, if I feel like this is as good as it's going to get for me, I can never lose this person because I'm never going to find another partner, you know, that gets me like they do, or that, you know, whatever. That's that idea of lack of perceived alternatives. And so often we find, again, that's kind of related to insecurity and low self-esteem. So people who experience those feelings often tend more towards this jealous type of reaction. And then final concept related to love that I want to touch on is the idea of polyamory, a lifestyle embracing multiple lovers. Important to note that this is not the same thing as swinging. So swinging is more of like emotional connection to one partner, but you've agreed upon being casually open in terms of your sexual relationships with other people. That's not the same thing as polyamory. Polyamory is being engaged in an emotional relationship with more than one partner. And it's agreed upon and approved upon by both partners at the get-go. And that that agreeal or even promotion of this idea is called compersion. That is the improving or embracing of a partner's emotional and sexual involvement with another person. So it does have that sexual component, but it's not just open sex. It's emotional as well. The text gives you some ideas of clear advantages and disadvantages of polyamorous relationships, but can anyone think of a couple off the top of their head that they'd be willing to share? What could you see as being beneficial in this type of relationship?
Maybe something concerning like sexuality, or like even like asexuality, like one partner. I'm not really sure, but I think just like involving like sexual preference, or maybe they feel like they can't fulfill those needs for each other.
Sure.
So that's also like of one of the theories of like they both are going to benefit from this type of relationship.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know, I think of the coined phrase, variety is the spice of life. That sort of speaks to this polyamorous approach. And as you mentioned, fulfillment, you know, it can be tricky to expect to have all of your needs met in one relationship. And so this opens up an avenue for that to not have to be the case. But there are certainly some, you know, clear disadvantages as well, in terms of, you know, navigating multiple relationships, the time expenditure, the energy expenditure. And those are probably, you know, reasons why this is not the normed lifestyle in our society. Polyamory is more of a not normed. I don't want to use the word deviant, but you know, somewhat deviant behavior. It does happen in pockets, in different areas. We talked about some polyamorous relationships early on, I guess last week on the call, but, and, you know, not necessarily married. There are partners who engage in these polyamorous multiple loves, and not be married. So, last time we were talking about them in the context of marriage relationships. Man with multiple.
Are there lives. Theories? Is it like theorized that humans are naturally monogamous, or or like, are we polyamorous? Like, you know, a lot of animals are sexually like polyamorous, but like when people say mate for life, I think they misunderstand that that means animals are sexually monogamous, but I've read that that means they're just like they stay with that mate, but they're sexually like polyamorous.
Yep. I think the research is still mixed on that. The jury's still out. Does anyone have thoughts on that question? Are we naturally monogamous, or are we sort of forced into that route because of social norms and we're more naturally polyamorous in our
relationships? I think it's become a social norm due to the evolution of like the ideas of marriage and what it should be, kind of. Because if you think about it, like 100 years ago, it was more normal, if we're honest, for a man to have more than one wife, to bear more children, to carry on his name. So I think as time has gone, it's been more, oh no, one wife, one husband, and that's it. So
appreciate that. Anybody got a similar or a starkly opposing view on that idea?
I think because we experience as the human race so much jealousy, like to extremes where people even murder because of jealousy, I think that it probably is in our nature to be somewhat monogamous, or at least like mate for life, because there are animals that are like mate for life that will kill like a threat. So I think there is something in our nature that makes us want to have just one partner that belongs to us and we protect it. So I don't think it's black and white like anything. I don't think it's black and white, but
yeah. And I think that's, you know, that's the key to me to understanding humans, is that very little is always or never black and white. We live in the gray area. And it's really a lot of the time it's related to our own experience and our own background, you know, in terms of how we understand these different ideas, for sure. All right, that is butting us up to the 3:15 mark, and that is all I have for you today. So just as a reminder for next time we come together, which is next week on Tuesday, please make sure that you are familiar with the content from chapter 3 and that you come ready to do some thinking and talking together, okay? Enjoy the snow, what's left of it.
Thank you.
Yep. Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. When do we need to check?
Sorry, two people were asking a question.
You go first.
When do we need to have read?